In this session, we're going to look at canned communications in a PLUS+1 guide program. We're not going to go over the canned standard itself. We'll assume that if you're looking to implement canned communications in PLUS+1, that you already know what canned is. Rather, we'll look at the canned components that you can build into your guide application to implement canned communications. We'll also look briefly at support for higher-level canned protocols within the PLUS+1 environment, such as J1939 and CAN Open. Let's get started. You'll find that there are four low-level CAN components that you can use in your guide programs: one transmit component and three receive components. Note that these are components, not higher-level function blocks, so you do not need a professional license to use them in guide programs. The transmit component is fairly straightforward. The CAN port parameter must be tied to the port signal from the API, either by connecting to the signal supplied in the template or by using a hardware component. The extended message ID and RTR parameters take the appropriate Boolean values. The message ID can be specified in either hexadecimal or decimal. Length specifies the length of the data array contained in the message, which can be from 0 to a maximum of 8 bytes. For data values which take more or less than 1 byte of memory, they must be combined or split to be put on the array. Boolean values use the encode component to build up to a byte of data, and 2 or 4 byte data types use the split component to break down to a signal byte. When true, the send signal tells guide to send the message at the end of the current execution loop. On the output side, the pending flag lets you know if a message sent in an earlier loop is still sitting in the output buffer, for instance, if it's been prevented from being sent due to CAN bus traffic. Overrun indicates that the output buffer is full and outgoing messages have been lost. Here's an example of how the simple CAN transmit component might be used in a guide program. The send signal tells guide to send this message every loop where its value is true. If you wanted to send the message regularly, you could use an oscillator component, as is shown here. In this example, the oscillator has a total period of 40 times its time base of 1 millisecond. The signal is on for 20 milliseconds and then off for 20 milliseconds. The send component gets a true value for one loop every time the oscillator output goes from false to true, which happens once every 40 milliseconds at the beginning of the period. You can also see in this example how larger data types use the split component to break up signals to be included in the data array. Smaller data types, namely Booleans, can be combined using the encode component. There are three receive CAN components, the first of which is the basic CAN receive component. It receives from 0 to 8 bytes of data in each message. The message ID must match the ID of the incoming message exactly. The protected parameter determines how multiple messages with the same ID arriving in one loop will be handled. If the protected flag is set to true, then only the first message with that ID will be read amongst all the CAN messages that have arrived during the last loop. Subsequent messages can be picked up by later CAN receive components in your guide code. All messages during the previous execution loop that are not allocated to a CAN receive component will be purged. If the protected flag is set to false, then the last message with this message ID in the receive buffer will be assigned to this component. If in fact multiple messages with this ID came in, then the overrun flag will be set to true. Length specifies the number of bytes of data attached to the message, with the data signal containing the actual array of values. Updated will be true on every loop where a valid message was received. Here's an example of how the basic CAN receive component would be used. If we split multi-byte data types on the send side, they would have to be combined on the receive side, as we can see here. Likewise, encoded Boolean signals would need to be decoded to find the original values. The updated flag is set to true for every loop that a message is received. The Can Receive with ID Mask component permits receiving a range of message IDs instead of looking for an exact match. For every bit of the mask, if the value is 1, the value of the message ID has to match the receive component ID for the message to be received. If the bit value is 0, it will be ignored. Looking at the extremes, if the mask is all 1s for every bit, then the message ID has to match exactly. In this case, the can receive with ID mask acts exactly like the basic can receive. The message IDs have to match exactly. On the other extreme, if the mask is all 0s, any ID will be considered a match, so the ID field is basically ignored. Can receive with data filter works similarly, but you are also able to filter messages based on the values in the data array attached to the message, in addition to the message ID. Once again, a bit value of 1 in the mask means that the incoming message value has to match what we've supplied to the component. A 0 means that we don't care. Here's how a can receive with message ID and data filter could be used. Here, our ID mask is all 1s, so we only get messages that exactly match our message ID of hex 180. We have 2 bytes of data mask, and our data mask for both of those bytes is all 1s, so in addition to matching the message ID, we'll only receive messages where the first byte is exactly hex 60 and the second byte is 0. Note that the protected flag is false, so if multiple messages came in the last loop meeting these criteria, we will only receive the last one. All previous messages will be lost. Remember that the basic CAN protocol doesn't assure delivery of a sent message. There is no handshaking in basic CAN, so you should always make plans in your program for what to do if CAN communications are interrupted. For example, say that we are receiving CAN messages in our propel function. In between commands, we continue to do what was commanded in the last valid message. If, however, we stop receiving messages completely, we don't want to continue indefinitely with our last command. Here's an example of how you could implement a very simple watchdog function in Guide. We'll wait 200 milliseconds since the last valid message before activating our watchdog function. If we haven't received anything during that time, we'll consider that there is a problem in CAN communications and set the propel value to 0. A very simple way to implement this in Guide is with the off-delay component. The updated signal will go to false the loop after the last received message, but instead of letting that signal pass directly through to our program, we'll hold it for a certain delay, in this case 200 milliseconds, after which we let it pass. If updated goes true again during that time, the timer will reset. So until now, we've been looking at the low-level CAN transmit and receive components, which are available to all Guide developers, including those using the free Express license. We also have extensive support in our function block library for the higher-level CAN protocol J1939 and basic support for CAN Open. Use of these and other function blocks, however, require either the permanent professional license or the temporary trial license. For the J1939 library, we have an extensive library of transmit and receive PGN messages, including address claim blocks and DM transport protocol messages. They are very easy to use. Drag in the block and attach the CAN port and source address signals. The data is presented as signals on a bus according to the SAE specifications, along with information in the template on signal names, data types, and value ranges. More extensive information is available in the PDF user manual. For the CAN Open protocol, we supply general use transmit and receive messages for SDO, PDO, network management, and other messages. You need to adapt the blocks to work with your particular electronic data sheet, or EDS. Once again, the J1939 and CAN-OPEN libraries, like all function block libraries, require a professional license to use. If you're interested in checking them out, though, you can use the trial license to test them and verify that they meet your needs. All guide function blocks are usable with a free 90-day trial license. We hope that this has been a useful introduction to using CAN messages in your guide programs. Remember that PLUS+1 Community Help is available on the PLUS+1 User Forum at plusoneforum.danfoss.com or contact the PLUS+1 Help Desk at PLUS+1 Help Desk, +1 Help Desk at danfoss.com. Thank you for your attention.